is there is no turning back. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth.
Good evening and welcome to yet again another edition of Youth Spin. I am your host, Jarvis, a.k.a. Mr. Controversy. And with me tonight is Radio Rebel. Rebel, say hello to the people.
Hi, Radio Land. Good evening to you.
And tonight's show will be a continuation of last week's show. We had an incredible discussion last week. It was entitled The Angola We Want. And this will be part two. With us tonight, we have a returning guest, Miss Marissa Harding Hodge, and I'll just go through her bio in case you weren't in with us last week. Marissa is currently a member of the National Ambassador Corps. She has a background in economics and management, obtaining her bachelor's degree from the School of Orient and African Studies, University of London, and a master's degree from London School of Economics. She is currently employed with the civil service in the Ministry of Finance. She is interested in economic development and governance issues. In her spare time, she enjoys spending time with her puppies and kittens, walks on the beach, and honing her knowledge of the Spanish language. Welcome, Miss Marissa Harding.
Good night, Jarvis.
Apologies on behalf of our other guest, yes, last week, Miss Rena Mead. She was unable to make it tonight. But in her stead, we have another youth ambassador, Mr. Kasim Ford. We are still awaiting Mr. Ford's arrival. Mr. Ford, if you can hear me, hurry up. Okay, so we'll go into...
There's a speed limit.
hurry slowly, Mr. Ford. Hurry slowly. So we'll go to our first dance break, give our guests and hosts a minute to catch themselves and gather their carts right before we get into this, what should be of extremely interesting discussion from what we had last week. So our first dance break is going to be On My Way by the man, Michael. Mark, that's Michelle, that's a man. DJ, announce the singer.
And we're back. That song was On My Way by Marshall Montano. Just a quick word from our sponsors. Youth Spin is sponsored by the Department of Youth and Culture. The Department of Youth and Culture is the main public agency with responsibility for youth and youth development and the preservation and promotion of Angola's cultural heritage and the arts. For more information about the Department of Youth and Culture, please call 498-3792 or 497-0969. Or email youth.culture@gov.ai. You may also visit the department's Facebook page at DYC Anguilla. You can also check Youth Spin out on our Facebook page, Youth Spin AXA, our Instagram page, Youth Spin AI, or go and view previous episodes on YouTube. Youth Spin is our page. And let's get straight into the discussion.
Before we do that, I have to do this. I know that my production team gets mad when I actually let out some studio secrets, but I have to do it because I think it's kind of amazing the fact that we have Namtree in here. So no, don't laugh, because there are a lot of youth out there that don't know that Namtree is a natural insect repellent. So we were experiencing some bug issues in the studio, and the youth, this is Youth Spin, and we already knew that you can get some Namtree branches from outside to help us with these mosquitoes. So for any youth out there that don't know that you can get Namtree and put it in your house to help run away the mosquitoes.
Actually, they're not working that well.
No. Well, they're working better than not having them, I would imagine. So you can just go ahead and get some Namtree and put them in your house, and you can save tons on bucks. Okay. So moving right into the discussion. Last week was very, very good. I was extremely, you know, I had a lot of good reviews on the discussion last week. The Angola We Want. We spoke about economic diversification. We spoke about some governance issues and policy changes we would like to see. This week, since some of the myself and some of the on my and my guest, Miss Harding, we both attended a consultation earlier this week on on the structure of the new National Youth Parliament, right? Because we haven't launched it yet, so I can name it whatever. Anyway, it's a National Youth Parliament. It's about to be launched pretty soon. So myself and other ambassadors and other key stakeholders were invited to a consultation. We were working on that. There's a quote that I want to use, and it says, "Unfortunately, young people are experiencing many challenges when attempting to have their voices heard in a formal decision-making space at local, national, and regional and international levels." And this came for the Youth Collaboration for Sexual and Reproductive Rights. Your thoughts on that, Ms. Harding? Do you think Angola's youth have a loud enough voice, if any voice at all in Angola? Because
as in terms of formal organizations, no. There's the Ambassador Corps, which obviously both of us are part of.
Mm-hmm.
There's the National Youth Council,
mm-hmm.
which is the umbrella group for the youth organizations in Anguilla. But do I believe that they are seriously consulted in terms of policy making and decision making at a national level? No, but I do believe all youth voices are somewhat heard and somewhat respected. I know the youth take to the forum, the social media, Facebook, and they make their voices heard. And people mm-hmm. do take their comments into consideration there.
Rebel, how do you feel your voice is being heard? Being the youngest person in the room, do you feel you have a voice and you're allowed to say what you're feeling? And
well, I guess. I think I do. Right now, it isn't coming to me how to answer the question thoroughly, but I think we do. Lately, we've been having a better chance to go to different functions and consultations. So I guess slowly but surely, we're being heard, and it's better than what was a previous decade ago, I would say. We're being heard now.
Actually, it's better than 2 years ago. I was just about to add. Since I've been back from studying in late 2011, early 2012, I've been involved in a lot of youth organizations here. And what I've been noticing is that our involvement, for the most part, and I know I'm always spoken to for being a pessimist, but I'm a realist. And what I've been noticing is that our involvement is ceremonial for the most part. You know, it looks good to have a youth sitting on wherever you have on panels and stuff. Like I've been, myself and colleagues from the Ambassador Corps, we've been utilized for different panels and different, you know, think tanks. But it's just a ceremonial position, I think. You've never seen any fruit coming from it. And this is just my opinion. So, but of late, the Youth and Culture Department is doing a really, really good job mm-hmm. on involving youth. And the Youth Parliament is another great example of the good work they're doing over there. So big up to Youth and Culture Department one time. But of late, you've seen more and more involvement of a substantial nature than just it being ceremonial. I'll have my guest have arrived, Mr. Ford. Welcome. Thank you for joining. I hope you didn't speed up when you heard me say hurry.
I know, I actually sped up when you started talking about the neem trees.
So. Oh, because you... I mean, well, that's cool though, huh?
Yeah.
Because me and you will be considered the old folk in the room.
Yeah.
And you'll expect us to know this type of thing. But for the 16-year-olds and the 22-year-olds to know... to know about the neem tree. I mean, I'm proud of these kids. You know, they know some... Our history, ladies and gentlemen, is alive and well. So... how do you feel about the youth involvement? Do you think it's just ceremonial, Mr. Ford? Or do you think we actually do have a voice? And because you've been around youth work much longer than I have been. You're the reason why I started youth work, actually.
Well, I must say that there's been involvement in recent improvement.
In recent days?
In
the last 2 years. Because I've seen drastic improvement in the last 2 years.
Some... very great improvement, but there's still a long way to go because, I mean, the way I look at it is young people have a voice. They can speak anytime, anywhere, but now the question is whether our decision makers are listening and actually doing something based on the suggestions that we are making, and that's a totally different story. We've seen many, many years, many, many national conferences with many, many recommendations. and there's been very little action that you can see that would have come out of those. But I'm happy with what is happening now.
One time I remember going to one of those conferences, and because of the particular season it's in, I'll omit several pieces of this story, but I think it's important. No, for real, because I don't want it to seem political at all. But I'll omit several parts of the story, but we made recommendations. We had our National Youth Conference, you know how that goes. We sat in a room for 2-3 days, came up with some recommendations. We went to the house, you know, we were really excited. And this was my first time I was ever on a youth conference. So I was really excited about going to the house to give, you know, recommendations that I worked on to ministers and good decision makers, you know. And we selected the person who would make the presentation. They made a beautiful presentation. They were spot on, you know, the tone of voice was perfect. The delivery was, you know, immaculate. And the minister that went up right after them, you know, stated that he's been in the house for X amount of years, which is longer than some of us has been alive. And with the people from his district, you know, he stated district by number and everything, he will be there for another X amount of years. I don't want to give the names of the districts or anything. You know, so that to me, when I saw that, that pretty much meant, and this wasn't recently. Mm-hmm. You know, when I saw that, I was like, you know, that meant that everything we just said, you know, really went into one ear and came out to the other, which is why I think, you know, up until recently, youth involvement has been on a ceremonial basis, and it shouldn't be. Another quote I want to use and have our guests give their opinions on it is, youth are not the future. They are our present, because without them, there are no future. How do you guys feel about that quote and as it relates to our voice? How does the future look if youth are the future? If you don't pay attention to them in the present, there is no future. How does our future look if you use that measuring stick?
Well, I actually like that quote, Jervis, because you hear always a lot of people saying, oh, the youth are future. No, we are alive and in the present. We're alive and in the present. So I really like the fact that that quote recognizes that. And I think more attention, more resources need to be focused on developing our youth, because they are our current. Our 18-year-olds are going to be our next generation of potential civil servants, potential holders of public office. So we need to focus on developing them now instead of looking to the future.
Exactly.
Repeat the quote.
Youth are not the future. They are our present, because if we don't pay attention to them now, we'll have no future.
I think the quote speaks for itself. I think it's a brilliant quote, because if I'm here now, how can I be a future? You know, because, I mean, that quote, every time I hear the quote, it goes beyond decision making. It goes to how children are raised. You know, we keep young children out of adult conversations. So how do they know to communicate on a certain level when they get to a certain age? There's so many things that that quote embodies, but the truth of the matter is that we need to, and I include myself and I include young people, because there's some young people that actually don't realize that they are for now. And young people need to realize that too, and take up the opportunities that are afforded to them now to actually be an influencer in their community. So we all need to acknowledge the fact that we play an important role in where our country is going. And we play that important role now. Mm-hmm. The people that are our leaders now will not be there 30, 40 years from now. So we need to be a part of...
You give them quite a long time, 30, 40 years. That's a lifetime.
Well, I like to believe that we are long living.
Maybe society. That's the problem. Maybe that's the problem where youth can't get their voices heard. You're living too long.
I know quite a few people that claim that they
really
that they have genes, good genes that old parents. So. Getting back to the point.
Ready your rebel. Being the youngest person in the room and in currently utilizing our education system. What would you like to see improved in our education system for the Anguilla we want to envision?
Probably, you said to see improve in the education system. I would think the whole restructuring of the system needs to be done. The whole system needs to be restructured before we could even do anything else. Probably the comprehensive system, I don't know if it needs to be revised in a sense, because it seems as though we're still not catering for everybody out there. So the whole system would need to be restructured.
Is it the system itself, or is it more the facilities? Because I know that they have some good classes in mind, but
the
facilities.
What facilities are you referring to?
Well, we were speaking about tertiary. I mean, not tertiary, but the comprehensive system, comprehensive school.
But what specific facilities? You mean the books? You mean the lab?
The buildings, the infrastructure.
So do you really think that the building is the reason why our math rates are so low?
I think it has a role to play.
I think it does not have a role to play. Children in many developing countries learn underneath trees with dirt and sticks. And they still do okay. I don't think our building should be our focus.
Touché.
Really? No, and that's it.
I'm interested to hear.
I will continue.
A lot of my friends are teachers, so, you know, and I know some of them are listening, and I apologize if you take offense, but I think we need to work on our, firstly, we need to work in the home. We need a cultural shift. We need parents to pay more attention to their kids, to encourage more academic learning. When you see your child run around playing out in the yard, tell them to get a book. I find that we need that cultural development. And then I think the schools, I think we need to work on the actual system. We need to put more resources into the key subjects such as English, mathematics. Those are fundamental skills. We have too many kids coming out of the school system and they don't have five subjects.
Well, I tend to disagree, though. I think the amount of success stories that the comprehensive school is telling out now. And we do have quite a few success stories. We have people getting 18 and 19 subjects now.
Like, you don't need 18 subjects to
get
to university.
I'm just saying that it's possible. That's what
I'm saying, though, Marissa. I'm not focused on those with 18 subjects. I'm focused on those with two subjects.
Okay, but in my time, the more subjects somebody came up with, and the average high school leaver, you know, did a lot worse in 2001 than in 2011. Like, the grades have actually gone up.
I got 10 subjects. I got 9 ones.
That's amazing.
No one asks me on my job application how much subjects I've got. Those are no longer considered. That was only a base level so I could get into tertiary education. I'm concerned about the kids who can't get into tertiary education. Because it doesn't matter whether you have 9 subjects or 18 subjects, you can still get into tertiary education with those.
Let's not turn this stuff back and forth. But if your goal was just tertiary education, I have a cousin that graduated Nova with two subjects. You know, if you take a college placement test or you take the SATs, and you know it's a substitute to be.
It's a substitute. It's something that you have to do because you didn't have.
Yeah. So, but what I'm saying though is it's possible to go to school with no subjects. So let's not let the subjects entire the
it's
subjects.
It's not possible to enter the civil service with no subjects.
Well, you switch your argument yet again because
I'm not switching my argument. I'm showing you
we were talking about
different avenues where having a certain level of subjects is important, and there is a certain minimum which should be. English is fundamental to so many avenues in your life. Mathematics too. I think the civil service is either 4 or 5 minimum subjects that you need. 4 subjects, including English. So that should be the benchmark. Every kid coming out of the high school, that should be the benchmark. And anytime I see that we fall short of that, it makes me feel sad. It really does.
Kasim, what do you think about all of this?
I won't even touch that argument.
I'm telling you.
Because
we won't win.
My concern is more along the lines of those young people that can't get any subjects. They in the bands 4s, 5s, 6s that They might have a skill, but they're just not that good academically.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a field I'm in. I'm in a technical field, and I think that I'm happy that recently the Education Act was passed, even though it took ridiculously too long. And there is now the TVET Council. But there's a whole lot of work to be done, and the mindset has to be changed in Anguilla in terms of...
Especially when it comes to the subjects, not to cut you off, but I was just thinking that the people that I most admire now are those without college educations who really didn't have the subjects, because the mechanics, the carpenters,
they still, the masons, need to get themselves certified.
The certification. I want to see our system going more towards, because most of those people make way more than I make with my degrees and all that. I mean, so what are we really focusing our attention on? Like,
well, I think
it's good when you can capture those that are academically inclined and have them succeed.
I don't want to discredit the good mechanics and plumbers and all of that stuff that are out there.
And with those skills, you have a level of independence. That's amazing.
But I think that the Anguilla Community College is making headwaves with regards to the developer vocational courses.
Yes.
I know they have mechanics. I think you teach there, don't you? You teach
electrical installation, air conditioning.
Oh, yeah?
And you can get your certification there.
Yes.
So, and I think we need to also focus more resources into the school. And it shouldn't be seen as something, you're not that bright, so this is what you do. It should be, that is one of your skills. That's one of your advantages. And you go that route. If something else is your interest, you're more mathematically inclined, then you go that route. It should be an alternative versus,
you failed at this. So
but the thing about it is that even if you're going into a technical field, you still need the basic maths, basic communication.
Oh, yeah, that too. That's why mathematics is fundamental.
We can discount the fact that something has to be done to improve those skills on a local level.
Yeah, when I was going to school, the kids that was doing those subjects, you felt like they were doing it because they weren't academically inclined. Like, I didn't have an opportunity, maybe I didn't want to, but I don't remember having an opportunity to take the woodwork classes. I really would have liked to learn to make a stool.
It's not like if you felt it, they were actually streamlined. Like, you probably went to school quite a long time before, like a decade before. But anyways, so for my generation, they were kind of streamlined into those areas. Are you okay, Jeffers?
I'm quite fine. Mr. Controversy and the show.
Mr. Controversy.
Yes, sir. Yeah, so moving right along. So we're going to say that in education, what we would like to see is that vocational classes or vocational courses, they don't be looked upon as being second rate or not as good as...
I mean, when I went to school in Jamaica, and the culture there is so different in terms of education, in that a lot of the guys that I was doing my engineering studies with probably didn't pass 4 subjects in high school. But they were able to go to a community college and get certain technical certificates in order to get themselves into an electrical engineering program. And I think that we need to create those avenues for young people that even though at that high school age, they mightn't be able to excel, that they could still make something of themselves. And I'm glad that a community college has those courses. It gives them the opportunity to do that. And I know in other countries, you can even go from the courses that a community college is doing right now into an engineering program. So I'm happy for the opportunities that they're providing. But there's still a lot to be done, because right now it's only electrical installation, mechanical, and plumbing. There's construction, travel, timber, there's a lot of plumbing, there's a lot of stuff out there. And what I was trying to tell you earlier is that I don't want to discredit all of the tradesmen that we have on the island right now. But a lot of people learned from another guy that might have been doing it wrong.
Okay.
And a lot of bad practices are coming up. And they, if, when they go to a course like the ones that are being offered right now, they can...
Is that a shameless plug you're doing? Are you looking for some business for the Anguilla Community College?
No, you can sign up for next semester.
I'm encouraging people to get themselves properly trained.
Development. You know? Continuous and, professional development.
And some people are late bloomers. Like I said, I knew people that left the Albina Lake Arts Comprehensive School with 2 CXCs and went on to graduate one of the most prestigious schools, one of them. In Florida, you know, so some people are late bloomers. So I think that in Anguilla, we don't have any human capital to waste, you know, so we should put something in place to catch any, you know, stragglers, people that may drop by the wayside. Like, we can't afford to lose not one person. So when you hear about the overwhelming statistics in the Her Majesty's prison, you know, it's alarming for me to think that, you know, that higher percentage of our population is incarcerated, not, you know, adding to our GDP, because we have nobody here. What's already? We have like 1,300 people. 13,000, sorry. Like, it's really a little bit of people, so you can't afford to lose anybody. And everybody should be, you know, collected. So that's something else. Education, we want to see.
Do they offer courses in the prison, do you know?
I think there were some courses being offered. I'm not sure, don't hold me to this. But I don't think there's any being offered at the moment. But there were some. Remember the prisoner that was at... The youth week, he said that there isn't any.
We did get some complaints at the last conference about
the conditions, but we won't touch on that.
But we need to definitely get out there and help those guys, because, you know, whatever. We're moving on. Healthcare. What would you guys like to see?
Wow. Service. World-class service.
What about facilities? Can I bring a facility now, Ms. Hannah?
No.
Can we get some good medical facilities? I would like waiting times.
I think there have been improvements right. in our facilities in recent times. We are one of the few islands in the region that have dialysis. There's a new X-ray ultrasound machine, you know, this new equipment, but there's always room for improvement, but you have to acknowledge where there has been improvement. Okay. Yes, but there are many complaints that I hear about going to the hospital and having to wait hours to be attended to, and I think that if you're in an emergency, it's an emergency.
If it's an emergency, I'm sure you won't wait.
No, but if it's an emergency, that's the thing. Okay. It's quite good to call the ambulance. You kind of get to skip the queues.
That statement was not the responsibility of Youth Spin.
I do not do it, but I am aware that ambulance is a queue jump, kind of.
Let's talk about civic education in schools. That's not quite civic, Ms. Harden, to call the ambulance for non-emergency events.
I don't do it, and I would definitely not recommend that anyone does it.
But there was a complaint to me recently as well from a young person that thought that more young people needed to be afforded the opportunity to study nursing, because apparently a lot of the retired nurses are being brought back. There's need for increased personnel, and but there's no, I guess, because there's no training.
There is, you know, the nurse cadet program that has been going on for quite some time, and I think the students benefit from it.
They benefit from it, but
that school program?
It is a school program, but it operates during school time, and then during the summer they get a job trained there. So even though students, you know, usually fifth farmers get a job trained there. Even the third farmers get to go once they were a part of the program. So it's like a sure thing to do every summer. You know, you have somewhere to go, somewhere to train, and it looks good on your resume at the end of the day.
Sounds good.
Nursing is a great job. I don't know why we don't have more locals wanting to be nurses, male and female. I know for Florida, everybody wanted to go to nursing school, including me.
How come you didn't make that step?
So I like business a little bit more. So we have three major issues in Anguilla. We hit on two already, and we're going to go to social development. Now, I've often wondered, you know, when you travel, especially to other Caribbean countries, you see the standard of living, right? And we in Angola, we have a much higher standard of living, generally speaking, right, than most Caribbean countries. Then...
Sorry, I'm shaking my head right now. And I will tell you why.
Go ahead.
Because I was doing a little bit of research today because I saw Martinique has recently become the newest member of the OECD, well, associate member of the OECS. Mm-hmm. And I was just shocked. No particular reason. I was just, it's a French, an ex-French colony, so it doesn't share a similar background as the rest of the OECS. But to be fair, as I was researching some information on OECS, Angola actually has, there's only one country in the OECS that has lower GDP per capita than Angola. And that would be Montserrat. So.
Well, in terms of standard of living, I'm speaking about concrete houses and lack of zinc fencing and that type of stuff. Like, our houses are really, really nice. Our cars, our paychecks are more...
Are we talking about social development?
Yeah.
It's very hard to measure standard of living by such measures.
The measuring stick I'm using is the standard by which
we live. That's just one.
Right? And that's where the houses and the cars and that type of stuff. Right? Okay. I'm saying that we have really nice homes. That's my measuring stick right now.
Okay.
We have really nice
homes. I agree with you. We have actually nice homes.
So you're saying that based on the fact that we have nice homes.
We have really, really nice homes.
We are good in the area of social development?
No. I'm talking.
Give me a second.
Swear to God, I will get to my point. What I'm saying, right, is that we have really nice homes, but the centers that are meant for community use, like community centers, like when you look at the ones that we have here and the ones that you would have in, let's say, the last Caribbean country I would have been to, would have been, let's say, Antigua. Right? When you compare our sports and recreation center to Antigua's, you know, there's no comparison. But then you compare the typical Angolan home to the typical Antiguan home.
I'm sure an Antiguan it's a palace. Is so offended right now.
Yeah. The same as Antiguan.
I'm just saying, though. I'm just calling it like I said. And I've been to some really nice homes in Antigua, don't get me wrong, you know?
I will let our other guest, Mr. Ford, respond.
When you look at the standard of living for personal items, then you get to community-based items. Like, it's completely different.
I'll talk about social development.
With regards to the recreational facilities and parental and family.
Because you would have noticed that in the last 30 years, we've had lots of capital investment. And not that much social investment. That's the point I'm really trying to get to.
That is true. I will agree with you.
Sorry, can I just ask?
It's the controversy.
Kasim, what are the houses like in Antigua? Is this the case?
We're not going there. We're not going there. But I definitely think that we should have seen the same way that there was other economic development, we should have seen social development to some proportion to that economic development, that boom that we had a few years ago. But even during that time, there seemed to be the same question of, we have no money. How are we going to build? There were always plans. We're going to build this facility here. We're going to build this facility there. And it never materializes to anything. And yet, we complain when our young people who have nothing better to do are out doing something better for them, I guess. I don't know.
See, social and capital development, the economists here, she might agree with me. She might this time. But social and capital development, they should go together, right? Because...
Economists?
If they don't go together, you have really nice places and a really high crime rate that nobody wants to come to, right? If you don't pay attention to the social fabric of a country. So if they're not hand in hand, it really comes...
What do you mean by capital development?
The building of hotel rooms and villas and that type of stuff. And social development would be the reconstruction of schools and recreational centers, that kind of stuff. No? Am I wrong? Am I saying something wrong?
I've never...
Please correct me, because you always do.
I know I do, and I'm a bit shocked right now, because I'm not familiar with the term capital development.
Really?
I'm really not. But I'm assuming that you mean economic development then, or do you mean infrastructure?
Capital, business.
Infrastructural development?
Oh, jeez.
Because, no, there's several types of capital. Human capital, financial capital. No, I'm just trying to pinpoint which one we're talking about here. Mr. Controversy?
But I think that we need a lot of social development beyond recreational facilities. We need homes for our disenfranchised young people. We need women's homes for those situations where there's domestic violence and facilities like foster homes. I mean, wow! And we have none of this. We have absolutely none of this, and. We do have foster homes.
We have some, but he probably means to say we don't have enough.
I mean, in terms
they're
of...
They're foster parents, not actual foster
right.
homes. But actually, I prefer that mode of caring in the community versus caring in the institutions. Because if you notice, a lot of developed countries are now moving away from institutionalized care. Because humans need some sort of social interaction that they don't usually get in institutions, which is key to human development, bond forming, social skills. So I prefer the foster parents versus institutional care.
That is a very credible point.
Yeah.
I don't agree to that.
But I do agree with what I think Jervis was saying earlier, that there can be economic growth without social development. And I think that we need to make sure going forward in the future that all economic growth is sustainable, that we're not going through peaks and troughs. I mean, the business cycle, there's natural peaks and troughs, but they shouldn't be so severe. And we need to make sure that there's some social support systems so no one has to go through unfair hardship during these times.
Before we continue, I have a press release from the Department of Youth and Culture on the subject of the Anguilla We Want campaign. For the next 2 weeks, the National Youth Ambassador Corps, NYAC, will be documenting youth views under the branded campaign, The Anguilla We Want. On any given day, you may see a street team having conversations with Anguillas under 35s. The NYAC will be approaching people and youth-focused organizations for the recordings. The Anguilla We Want can focus on any topic and will collect the perspectives of various youth people explaining their dreams and wishes of what Anguilla could be. National Youth Ambassador Kasim Ford, who's right here with us, said Anguilla is filled with youth, with young people, with dreams for their nation. Some of us carry the hopes and uncertainties of tomorrow on our shoulders. I hope that this campaign informs our leaders that the decisions they make matter to young Anguillians. Our prospective leaders should also see this as a firm challenge from our young people to carefully consider their actions moving forward. Young persons are asked to visualize and articulate their Anguillian utopia, share ideas for implementing their individual and collective dreams for Anguilla. All young people are encouraged to participate. And we also have another one. The Anguilla National Youth Ambassador Corps is a component of the Ministry of Social Development, Department of Youth and Culture's on-stream program. It seeks to create a structured opportunity for young people to participate in decision-making through involvement on decision-making fora, while at the same time developing their capacity for leadership. For more information on the NYAC and this campaign, please contact the Department of Youth and Culture for the attention of the youth officer, Ms. Jolene Robin, at 497-7999 or 497-0969 or email Jolene at jolene.robin@gov.ai.
And also to listen to the audience, don't forget you can be a part of the Anguilla We Want campaign in this discussion by going to the Youth and Culture Department and speaking to the campaign officer, Ms. Robin. So don't forget, you can have your voices heard on the Anguilla You Want at the Youth and Culture Department and speak to Ms. Jolie and Robin during the hours of 8 to 4.
And there should also be a street team coming around soon to the various communities.
There should be, yeah. So right back into the discussion. We have some tips here, some key recommendations for young people for the post 2015 agenda in the world we want, not just the Angola. And we were speaking here, and on point number 9, they have recognizing that climate change is one of the biggest challenges facing our young people in this generation, and to ensure that a sustainable development agenda is concluded. Excuse me, I think I'm in for a pair of glasses. Recognizing that climate change is one of the biggest challenges facing young people this generation, and ensure that a sustainable development agenda included integrating the central to the new development goals. How do you feel about climate change, Mr. Ford? And do you think, and we in Angola, being the tiny dot that we are, can have any kind of influence on that?
I think every mickle mecca muckle.
But how much CO2 are we actually producing, though? We can't be we can't be contributing to climate change.
Every little adds up, you know?
Yeah, I mean, climate change is something that's affecting us. So if it's affecting us based on what the larger countries are doing, why should we not do anything about it because we're only contributing a little bit?
We had a gentleman, somebody help me with his name. Mr. Lewis? Jibiri Lewis?
Jibiri
Lewis. Jibiri Lewis. And he was granted a scholarship to MIT for a science project that he did. And what I don't want to, but Rissa Stong is stupid. You know, he did something with some machine and made electricity from the wave power of Windward Point. And he was saying that he could actually develop something that would be able to, you know, sustain Angola's electrical needs with some leftover. You know, that's a, and because we in Angola, because of our size and our population, we are unique that we can, you know, we can insure 13,000 people. Like, there, I know companies that have hundreds of thousands of people insured. You know, we can provide green energy free of cost at a very low cost to everybody in Angola. Like, those opportunities are there. So, you know, we have an opportunity to go green. We have young talent in Angola that can do it too.
It's also an employment opportunity, actually.
Yeah.
So also electricity.
This is a topic that is very dear to my heart because it's a field that I work in.
There you go. That's why I brought it up.
I know time is running from us, and I don't want to cut you off too much, but as soon as you finish your point, I want to get to one right before we finish. This one is probably going to take a while, so as soon as you finish yours, continue.
Okay. I'll make it brief. I believe that renewable energy is the way to go.
Most definitely.
When you're talking about the economics of it, the cost of fuel, the fact that you have to bring in fuel from overseas, and the fact that you don't have to do that and you can use your own resources. Just adding one and one makes two, you know. Countries around the world are moving towards renewable energy in order to cut costs and these kind of things. Businesses, enterprises, it is the way to go. It helps us to become more energy independent. It helps in climate change in terms of those toxic fumes coming from the generators, the burning of diesel and other fuels. And it's unfortunate that we haven't been moving full speed in that direction. And I would say, as a young person in Angola, I think that that is the direction that we should be going in.
Free electricity, right? I think so too. Free electricity, what an amazing
thing. It won't be free electricity.
Everything has a cost.
Compared to what we're paying now, we'll be really close to free.
It takes an investment,
of course,
to get to that point, and it takes resources, and it is going to take people willing to make that investment and see that investment return over a long term, rather than looking at the cost now. You know, it takes long-term vision. And that's all I'll say about that topic.
Okay, moving right along.
Mm-hmm. Okay, civic education in our schools. What do you think about that topic, Marissa? Civic education in our schools.
I think it'll be awesome. I think whenever you educate citizens about their rights and about the community that they live in, I think that's beneficial to everyone. And I'm not familiar with the school system now. It's been quite a while since I've been there. Do you know whether they're currently offering courses in it?
No.
No?
Not.
Not?
Well, unless you're counting law, I don't really... But actually, I don't even see that as civic education in itself because... I don't.
Is that Anguillan law that they're...
Yes.
Yeah. The law for Cape, then, I think it is.
You could say so.
No, but I think it would be good. Yeah, I think it would be a plus.
To teach a people about themselves makes them a proud people. I mean, in the Anguilla of yesteryear, that pride was natural. And I think we're losing it because of lack of civic education. And to learn about the Boston Tea Party that has, when I was in history class, that's what I learned about, if I'm remembering correctly, the Boston Tea Party. That's the first time I heard about it in Albina Lake High Comprehensive School. And it had nothing to do with us at all. You know, but then we don't hear about the revolution. Like, if it wasn't for the home I grew up in, you know, a lot of the revolution stories that I know and the people who took part and the heroines, and you know, without the home that I grew up in, I wouldn't have known that. And unfortunately, a lot of these people are dying before they actually receive their flowers or the accolades from the youth who they, you know, the people that helped to get us electricity. You know, this is the time when they're starting to pass. They're now 75, going on 80, and they're starting to leave us, and they haven't been, you know, being recognized as yet. So definitely, I think that should be in our school system by next semester. I hope they're working on it as we speak, because I don't see how it's not been in there for so long.
Yeah, but the question is, how will they fit it in with the current system that we have?
Take out the Boston Tea Party.
No, we don't think we do that.
Yeah. Like, that should be in a history class. I don't know what y'all are learning in history, though.
I did history in the Albina Lake High School. And you have to follow a certain curriculum because the exam you sit is either the Cape or the CSEC. So you can't take up, well, I don't think Boston Tea Party was a topic, but you can't take that out. I know that we have physical education. I know that we have, I think it's called personal, social, and health education.
Unless they fit it in during that
Perhaps
period.
Perhaps we could fit it in during those times.
Maybe we can do it before you have a external examination. Maybe we can do it first to third form. I know there's a way to get it done. And I mean, something as important as that needs to be done. Maybe you can do it before there's international examinations done. Maybe you can do it first to third form. And then fourth form, you go into the curriculum for CXC. It's possible. There's a way to do it. I know. There has to be.
Well, I guess you should go down to the school and do some consulting, Jervis.
So civic education definitely should be in our school system. What else would you change if you could as a closing statement, if you could wave a magic wand and change anything to the Anguilla you would like to see, what would you do, Mr. Ford? Mr. Hodge, Mrs. Hodge, what if you had a magic wand, Mr. Ford is going quiet at me. Well, what would
so
you change
just
if you could change
mister.
One thing? What would you change to create the Anguilla?
Better yet,
let's
probably rephrase that question to what would you like to say to our leaders about these youth issues?
Here we go. Somebody say something. Both my guests, the cat got both my guests' tongue.
What is the issues that we've been talking about?
We've been talking about the changes we would like to see in education, healthcare, social development. We've been talking about civil education and our civic education in our schools. We've been talking about development, social and capital.
I think
we've
I
been
want
talking
to
about quite a few things.
I don't think specifically say to our leaders. I think I want to say to Anguilla at wide. I think we really need to focus more on education. I think we need to start paying attention to our kids' performance at, you know, high school, primary school level, and start encouraging more reading, those kind of activities. That's one of the angles I want, a developed society. And education is one of the key starts to development.
Thank you, Ms. Ives. Mr. Ford, any closing statement?
Well, I would like to see a unified vision for this country. That's what I'd say. For way too long, we've been rocking east to west based on which government we have. This government feels like going this way. That government feels like going that way. I think that Angola needs to come to a place where everybody's moving. So a unified vision, there needs to be, I would like to see a government that comes in that is willing to sit down with all stakeholders at the table and say, let us plan 20 years ahead for Angola. And along with us as young people at the table, and create some good, credible plans that can take Angola where we would like to see it. I don't think I need to go back to those issues. I've been talking to about those issues for years. Let us sit down and make a plan that is real and measurable and attainable, and let's get it done.
And one final question. How do we empower young people to take charge so that the Anguilla they want is an Anguilla they helped to create? Anybody?
How do we?
As Jervis said earlier, we need to make sure that, you know, whenever their opinions are sought, that it's not ceremonial. It's not, you know, you just have this kind of organizations there for functional purposes or just to tick boxes, but you really truly seek, recognize, and try to understand some of the youth issues and their views and what they want.
Well, when I came in, I heard some little chatter. Maybe that was when I was listening about the youth parliament that's coming up. I really think that that's going to be a great opportunity to empower some young people to actually take charge and be influential in some of the decisions that our government is going to make. And I think that I really love that program for the training, and it's going to be really empowering. And I think that young people are going to be, I hope that our young people grasp that opportunity. And if they do, it is going to be great for them, not only for them, those that will run for to be MPs and stuff like that, but for other young people seeing them and seeing the influence that they could have.
Just, I think it would be beneficial for Angola on the whole to hear the debate in a different style, in a different form, from a different generation. So I'm excited about the youth parliament as well. I wish something like that was available when I was officially considered a youth, but you know, it's...
You sound like you're old, so man.
Cassie, we're the old men in the room, haven't you realized? We went sleeping, woke up old one day.
You went sleeping, woke up
old. You're older than me. I sat into a consultation last week, and I've been, you know, hosting the youth spin for a little bit, and I've had an opportunity to speak with quite a few promising youth. And the truth is that, and in my heart, I honestly believe that our future is bright. Our future is a lot brighter than our past, and our past ain't that dim. So, you know, I'm excited for the future of Angola, and I'm excited for the youth parliament and the opportunity that it's going to open up for MPs and Angola on the whole, just to have a different venue, a different platform for that argument to be heard. And my producer is telling me to remind you guys that on April 22nd, we have that once in a 5-year opportunity where we go and
exercise
your right to vote. That's the loudest speech you can ever make. You know, that's the loudest noise. If you want your voice to be heard, go ahead.
I just wanted to say that my colleagues in Guyana, they had the election some time ago. There was the youth council down there ran a campaign, vote like a boss.
Vote like a boss. you know, last in 2010, me and a couple of other Angolians who were going to school in Florida, we started a Facebook page named Choose or Lose. And it got up to about 1,100 people. And, you know, you were sending out little messages. We had a countdown going on last time. I guess we were unemployed and didn't have much to do at the time. But we weren't able to do that now. But choose or lose. It's still choose or lose. If you don't choose, then you automatically lose. If you don't choose, if you don't go out and make your voice heard, you have no right to say anything about anything for the next 5 years. You know, so you definitely need to listen to the issues, you know, listen to everybody. Don't enter the whole political situation with a bias from your parents, you know, from your grandparents or your friends. You know, listen to everybody and formulate your own opinions. You know, think for yourself.
Yes. And cast your vote.
And cast your vote. Look for the person who you feel can best represent you.
Mm-hmm. Angola. Angola too.
Mm-hmm. So, thank you guys so much for listening. And I'd like to say thank you to our guests for coming, Mr. Ford. Thank you so much for your extensive wisdom and for sharing it with us here on Youth Spin. Thank you to our beautiful listening audience for listening. You know, you guys are with us every Thursday, and we really, really appreciate it. And to the guy from Churchill that said we don't talk about politics, you know, remember, we're asking you to go out and vote. You know, please go out and vote. Let your voice be heard. It's your democratic right. So until next week, we're going to leave you with Turn Out for What? And I hope you turn out to vote on the 22nd. So this is your boy, Jarvis, a.k.a. Mr. Controversy, signing off for yet another Youth Spin.
I'm Darren, and I'm turning out for education.
I'm EJ, and I'm turning out for merit equality.
My name is Lil Lena, and I'm turning out for reproductive rights.
My name is Ayana, and I'm turning out for human rights.
Hi, I'm Natasha, and I'm turning out for prison reform.
I'm Sophia, and I'm turning out for women's rights.
I'm Devendra, and I'm turning out for deforestation.
What's up? It's Lil Jon, and I'm turning out for the legalization of marijuana.
I'm Ireland, and I'm turning out for global warming awareness.
I'm Gabriel, and I'm turning out for racial equality.
Rock your vote, rock your vote, rock your vote, rock your vote, rock your vote.
Hi, I'm Fred. I'm turning out because I want to impress my friends. That's the only reason to ever do anything.
Turn out for what? Turn out for what? For what? For what?